Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup and welcome to station number 2 where we are going to focus on the humerus. And hopefully you recall that this is the bone of the arm. We will only have one bone in the arm as opposed to what we have in the forearm with the paired bones. So you can see we have a fairly prominent proximal end and a fairly prominent distal end. The proximal end will be associated with the shoulder. The distal end will be associated with the elbow. So let's start with the proximal end. We're looking at a more posterior view here. And you can see one of the most prominent things that's associated with the proximal end will be the head of the humerus. And the head of the humerus is always going to be facing medially. It has got to head towards that glenoid fossa or glenoid cavity of the scapula. So that will always help in terms of getting your bearings on some of the other structures. Particularly for me, even when I'm looking at the distal end and trying to tell if I'm looking at a medial epicondyle or a lateral epicondyle. There are two necks associated with the humerus. You will have the anatomical neck, which is going to be just distal to the head, kind of before you really get to the tubercle regions. This is what's kind of referred to as a true neck. So it's always just distal to the head, and it's where it's a relatively a little bit thinner of a bone. Then you will have the surgical neck, and you don't have a surgical neck in all bones that have a head, but we do in the humerus. It's going to be just distal to both the tubercles, and it's kind of away from this complex of the head and the tubercles. And it is here on the surgical neck that you're going to have some important neurovasculature that's going to wrap around the surgical neck. And specifically that axillary nerve that is going to innervate the deltoid and the teres minor is going to wrap around here. And the reason that we have a separate named neck is because this particular area of bone is one of the more commonly one of the more common areas to have fracture of the humerus. So that is why it has a separate named area, just because of the frequency with which clinicians had to focus on this area. So if you have a fracture to the surgical neck, this could directly affect the axillary nerve and directly affect the actions of the deltoid muscle. Okay, now moving to the tubercle portion. So here again, we've kind of flipped the humerus. So now we're looking at an anterior view. And I know that because I can see the lesser tubercle here. And the lesser tubercle is always anteriorly facing. If you recall, the lesser tubercle is going to be the attachment site for the subscapularis muscle. Opposite the head, you will have the larger, greater tubercle, and it's larger as its name would suggest. It, as I mentioned, is always going to be lateral, and this will always be medial because there is the head of the humerus. The greater tubercle is going to have the other three of the four rotator cuff muscles attaching here. So that's why it is larger than the lesser, which only has one. And between these two structures, you have the intertubercular sulcus, sometimes referred to as the bicipital groove. So right between the two tubercles, this you're going to have muscles attaching here. Specifically, your latissimus dorsi muscle is going to be attaching on the floor of the intertubercular sulcus. You'll have some others kind of attaching along the lips. But really, this sulcus serves as a protected passage for the tendon of the long head of the biceps. And there'll be a ligament that kind of runs across this area that keeps that tendon down and doesn't allow bowstringing to occur during certain movements. So really protecting that long head tendon. Okay, now we're moving to the distal end of the bone. And I did put up a picture of the full humerus, just so we can remember where that head is, because if you remember where the head is, you can always remember what's medial and what's lateral, and that helps me when I'm looking at a more distal portion. So the lateral epicondyle, means it's just going to be a little bit above, kind of the condyle. And in most cases, it'll be just superior to the condyles. The lateral epicondyle is going to be this smaller one, whereas the medial epicondyle is almost always considerably larger than what you have on the lateral side. And it should be on the same side as the head of the humerus. So recall those common tendons are going to attach here. So you'll have the common extensor tendon for the lateral epicondyle and the common flexor tendon for the medial epicondyle. Now, looking at the actual condyles, you have two separate ones. You'll have the capitulum, which means little head. It is where we have the articulation of the head of the humerus. And if you recall, that head of the humerus looks very kind of button shape, so it'll fit pretty well right here. And then you have the trochlea, which is very spool shape. This kind of means, this means pulley. And this allows for that articulation of the trochlear notch of the ulna. So that kind of semi-lunar size notch will move around the trochlea of the humerus. Now, if you look at a posterior view of the same structure, this is an anterior view right here. And so you can really see the condyles well. If you switch to the other side and look at a posterior view, you can't see them quite as well. You can see a little bit of the trochlea. You can see the medial epicondyle being larger than the lateral epicondyle. But really the dominant thing on the distal portion of a posterior view is going to be the olecranon fossa. And it's quite large, it's quite prominent, and something I think that's pretty hard to mix up with another structure. And this allows for the accommodation of the olecranon of the ulna during full extension of the elbow joint. So if you kind of just feel your own olecranon or the back of your elbow, and you fully extend, you can kind of see and feel where that's fitting in a little bit better and projecting less than when you have full flexion of the elbow. All right, so those were a lot of structures. There's a lot of important things going on in terms of the humerus, both in terms of articulation as well as muscle attachment. So review these. Make sure to ask me if you have any questions early and often. And I thank you for your time and attention, and I'll see you at Station 3.